Welcome to Global VID, a podcast about original productions and international TV and film distribution. I'm your host, Eric Y. LaPointe, and we're about to learn how people in our industry are expanding their footprint and finding the right partners around the world. This show was created by NNOW Global and is also available as an audio format on Apple, Spotify, or your favorite podcast application. Welcome to today's episode of Global VID. I am super pleased to introduce you to the leading edge Vancouver creative studio, Kelly&Kelly, who specialize in comedic content. The company got their start producing professional podcasts well before it became a hip trend. So get this, Kelly&Kelly's work has garnered 80 million listens and views across multiple platforms. They are best known for creating This Is That, a satirical comedy show for the CBC here in Canada, and This Sounds Serious, a fiction crime comedy podcast that has been named Best of the Year by Apple Podcasts, IndieWire, and The New Yorker, while also winning the 2020 Podcast of the Year award at the Banff World Media Festival. They've produced for clients including Google, Luminary, CBC, Al Jazeera, and The New York Times. I'm excited about this episode, so let's dive right into the business of professional podcasting and meet two of the Kelly&Kelly principals, Pat Kelly and Lauren Berkovich. So hello, Pat and Lauren. How are you? Welcome to the show.
Hi, Eric. Thanks for having us.
Yeah, we're excited to be here.
I'm excited to have you because we're going to be talking about the business of podcasting, which is amazing. So let's get started with you guys. And before we start talking about the podcasting business, let's start with the first segment of the show, which is how did you guys get started in the entertainment industry? So Lauren, why don't we start with you? What first brought you to the entertainment world, whether it be television production or whatever else you were doing?
Yeah, sure. I have very unlikely beginnings in the entertainment industry. I actually have a degree in environmental science. So it was not my plan really to get into media, but I ended up after university working at a Vancouver-based counterculture magazine called Adbusters. I wanted to change the world. I was very excited. And this was the way I wanted to kind of do it, through communicating to people. And Adbusters was a really interesting kind of media foundation to start at because it was very outspoken. There's no advertisements. Kind of sparked this inside of me that that's what I wanted to do. And we started the Occupy Wall Street movement, and it was just a very foundational kind of thing in my life. And then from there, I realized like print is a tough medium to be in. So I wanted to expand beyond that. And I ended up wanting to be in documentary films, which led me to factual unscripted work in Vancouver, which then led me to scripted work in Vancouver and working for different production companies around town. And then I ended up working with Kelly&Kelly. I had a child. My husband is the other Kelly in Kelly&Kelly. And after our first child was born, Pat and Chris were making some video content for their radio show on CBC called This Is That. And they asked if I could produce it, and I was happy to. And then I kind of got through Chris, who is a original kind of adopter of podcasting. He made the CBC's first ever podcast. He interviewed the individual who coined the term podcast. He kind of scooped me into this world of Kelly&Kelly, and I started producing podcasts from there, and I've never looked back. It's been amazing.
How did that come about?
I forget. It's this British guy, but he wrote in an article, like, what are we going to call these things? And he had a bunch of examples. I forget what any of the other ones were, but it was like ear listen or ear tune or ear radio or eyes. And then I, because of the iPod, yeah, he came up with podcasts.
And this is totally off topic, but how did Adbusters end up creating the Occupy Wall Street movement?
That is very off topic. No, we had been looking at what was happening with the Arab Spring, and we put this spread in one of the issues of the magazine that said it had this poster of a ballerina on the Wall Street Bull, and it said hashtag Occupy Wall Street, September 17th, bring tent. And we put that out into the world, and we put out a newsletter that kind of said, like, we're seeing this uprising in the Middle East. Could this ever happen in America on September 17th? Let's go Occupy Wall Street. And after that, it just like the spark took off and people ran with it. Like Anonymous ran with it and it just became this, it's this totally thing. And we were sitting in a basement in Vancouver. Like none of us were even in New York, and it just like hit a nerve with people and it took on a new life. But it really like made me believe like, wow, like an idea can capture the world's imagination and make a huge impact. And that's something that's really stuck with me and the lesson I took from it, which was really incredible.
Well, that's awesome. So you heard it here first, or maybe not first, but Occupy Wall Street was born in Vancouver. Oh my God.
It was.
And Pat, how about you? How did you get your start in the entertainment business?
Well, mine was probably a little bit more traditional and less meaningful than Lauren's, but I started out as a live performer and as a comedian. And so when I was graduating university and coming out of, well, it started even earlier, coming out of high school, I was really interested in comedy and improv. And so when I finished university, I moved to Toronto and got into the second city there and was performing, live comedy every night in my early 20s. Through that, I, was able to sort of get some attention from producers and people working in film, television, commercials. And I got a gig very early on at YTV hosting the after school show there called The Zone, which sort of leaned heavily into my comedic abilities and my, improv abilities. And it was just an amazing job to be like that young, sort of thrust into television. And it was kind of a thing where you were given the freedom to sort of do all sorts of things on the show, like learn from, the camera people and the producers on how to put segments together and how to sort of assemble a segment. If you have an idea for some sort of comedy segment, it's like, how do you actually pull that off and book it and do all that stuff? So it was really a seminal kind of experience for me early on and kind of planted the seed for me that I had an interest in sort of the other side of the camera, not necessarily just being the, the funny guy in front of it. So I still continued to perform and, pursue comedy, but at the same time, I always had kind of an eye on producing and writing. And so I would sort of take every opportunity I could, as far as television was concerned, to sort of, get a writing job on a TV show or even pitch stuff early on. To the early days back then was the Comedy Network. So a longtime collaborator of mine, Peter Oldring, and I, we had a show early on when we were young on the Comedy Network, and we kind of self-produced the whole thing. Wow. So it was just really like ad hoc kind of.
What was the name of that show on the Comedy Network?
It was called Good Morning World, and it was sort of short-lived. It started as a web series. So we started it right when internet video kind of came along. We sort of jumped on this opportunity to produce our own stuff. And it was the early days of the Comedy Network. So they caught notice of it and said, why don't you try to turn this into a bit of a TV show? And we'll put it on at like 1:30 in the morning. So that was, again, another example of just sort of learning by doing, and then teaming up with Chris and really learning about how to, make audio and what goes into that. I just fell in love with it right away. And so as we continued to do this, that, we decided to kind of branch out and do Kelly and Kelly and make our own stuff. Podcasting is something that is like kind of exciting because it's new and there's still so many possibilities, and there's, we're just sort of seeing the beginning of it, so that, I'm always kind of trying to look for things that are like new and exciting and at least haven't been kind of done before, because it feels like that's where I get most stimulated. So I'm excited by the work for sure.
So when was This Is That originally launched on CBC?
It would have been 2010-ish, 2011. And then it ended up running for 9 years or 9 seasons. So it was about 8 years, I guess. But it started out as a summer replacement show. So they often would put these sort of things, experimental things on in the summer when the regular shows went down for a break. And we kind of came in there and started as a summer thing. And I think a lot of people, listeners, responded to it and were kind of like, what the hell is this? We like it. And so we were able to keep going.
So, and in those early days, like how did the CBC take advantage of the podcasting component of it? And was there any difference between what you would hear on radio and how it was released on podcasting?
CBC radio itself would just simply sort of take the radio shows and make them available on podcasting. And so that's what we were doing with the show, but we sort of really realized there was such an opportunity to like up the sort of digital presence of a radio show. So we did a lot of work around kind of, you know, Lauren spoke to the idea that we did video content that was like companion to the radio show. Yeah. We really worked social media. We parsed out every little segment that we did in the radio show and made them an individual thing that you could put up on social media and share around on Facebook. And so it really garnered a lot of attention digitally. So I think a lot of people who were not terrestrial radio listeners thought of this as that as a podcast and would just come directly to the podcast feed to get the show and listen to it whenever they want. And we still have people who are, you know, craving that because, you know, it was a great show for like a long drive.
When was Kelly and Kelly officially formed in that case? So that's when you started collaborating together. But when did the company launch?
2016.
Yeah. So 2016, we decided to sort of, you know, take the leap and start something new. And, you know, again, it wasn't necessarily going to be totally audio forward. We just had this idea of like putting all these skills together that we had sort of established through collaborating together. You know, the video work had been really successful. The companion video stuff that we did with CBC had been really successful. So we thought maybe let's do a little bit more of that. And really recognizing that there was so much opportunity in podcasting to do kind of elevated comedy stuff that was a little bit more scripted and maybe kind of had taken on some of the sort of like prestige elements of radio and put that in podcasting. Cause I think a lot of podcasting, you know, is pretty simple. It's one guy with a microphone interviewing two people. Ta-da. But we, you know, we really did. We learned a ton doing the show about really elevated production techniques and sound design and Foley and world building and really kind of like theater of the mind sort of stuff. And so we wanted to apply that to a whole bunch of different things. And we're still doing that and you know, learning every day how to do that more efficiently and really trying to find ways to break formats and do all that kind of stuff. Cause there's so much potential that still, I think, hasn't been tapped entirely in audio. So
before we dive into that potential and the business of podcasting, what do you guys make of the explosion of podcasting in the last year and a bit during this pandemic? And, you know, case in point, this very podcast was launched during the pandemic. However, I did have the idea of doing it before this whole Zoom world. And I remember thinking this is going to be complicated. I would have either had to go into Vancouver, rent a space like yours, like your studio. And then this whole Zoom thing started and I realized, well, I don't have to go into Vancouver. I don't have to invite people into White Rock, but we can do this right here, right now. And obviously I'm not the only person that did this because it exploded. So what do you guys make of that? Is that interfering or is that good for business?
It's not dissimilar to the fact that when consumer cameras came around, you know, the idea that people were all going to start making TV shows or making movies. Yeah. I mean, there was certainly an interest in everybody being able to do that. And I think one of the things that people are attracted to with podcasting is that it's very accessible and it is very, you know, now, especially year after year, the technology has become more user-friendly and very simple and microphones have become better. And, you know, so you can do that. And I think where we position ourselves to the analogy I was making around consumer cameras is that we are really playing in kind of a premium space where we really want to focus on making like ear movies. And that requires a little bit more production and a little bit more effort and a little bit more time than most of the sort of chat podcasts that we're partaking in right now. So
right.
I think people are attracted to it because it is the lift is easier than making a television show. It's easier than getting a whole bunch of people together to do lighting and get a studio and all that kind of stuff. And I think it's a real direct route to an audience too, is also what I think people are kind of finding, like yourself, you're you know, finding that there's this really sort of convenient way to build and attract an audience and create a relationship with somebody in a different way.
Yeah, I'm just gonna build on that and say, like, I love it. I love that so many people are getting into it. And yes, like you're saying, one, it's COVID safe production, which was so big in the last bit. The technology has made huge leaps and bounds in the last year and a half as well, which is incredible, the remote recording technology. and people have the time, which is great. Mm-hmm. And, but we kind of sometimes equate it to, yeah, like blogging of the early 2000s, like Pat was saying, like it's a more crowded field now as well. Like starting a podcast 7 years ago is different than starting it now as term in like, in the sense of discoverability and audience building. Same, like if you were a very early blogger and you built this huge audience and versus if you tried to build a blogging business, like, you know, in the last year or two, it's much harder. So it's like Pat saying, accessibility is there. Anyone can make it. It's incredible. Everyone should, but it's still a shit ton of work. Like, it's not easy. It's not like, oh, turn it on, record something, and then you're going to have this huge audience. So I think I'm encouraged by the fact that so many people are getting in. I love it. I want people to have a platform, but it's not easy to build something. That's right. Still incredibly difficult. And one thing we've always found kind of interesting, kind of getting into the business of podcasting, but I'm just going to throw it out there, is when you looked at television, it's like there were gatekeepers, the networks, and then YouTube came along and everyone could self-publish, and like how amazing that was and what that did. It just like broke it open to anyone could have their own television station. I still remember like YouTube being Time's Person of the Year, and it was like a thing on the, you know, on the magazine was like this reflecting computer back at you. But podcasting is kind of the opposite. Like it was an open ecosystem to begin with. Anyone could self-publish. That's like the defining feature of podcasting, is that it was an RSS feed and it allowed you to have subscribers and you could publish to your own audience. And now what we're seeing is now gatekeepers are coming up. So it's a bit of like the inverse of what we've seen with television.
Let's talk about that now. So let's dive into the business of podcasting and those kind of deals. What was the first deal that you guys did in podcasting here in Canada or outside of Canada, whichever came first?
It was from America.
Mm-hmm. Oh, great. Perfect. Automatically international. Okay.
Well, it's actually some company out of New York, Slate Magazine, started a podcast network called Panoply, which now no longer exists.
Does Slate Magazine even exist anymore?
It does. It's Slate Media Group still exists. So we were, but Panoply at that time was the same podcast network that Malcolm Gladwell was on. And there was a bunch of other big shows on this network. And they had seen This Is That. And they thought that it was brilliant. And they wanted a podcast kind of inspired by a character from This Is That video. Okay. Mm-hmm. Who was a thought leader. It was actually Pat acting out a thought leader, like a fake TED talk. And it was really funny. And they were like, we want that as a podcast. It was kind of a satire on like thought leaders and kind of work hack podcasts and
faux entrepreneurship and all that kind of stuff. Yeah. They were really attracted to the sensibility and the sense of humor, which was kind of like really rewarding to us, because that's how we sort of like really wanted those videos, the This Is That videos, to sort of like be put out into the world. We wanted, you know, obviously the satire and the comedy to come through, and to have them sort of just have that come across their internet and see that there was sort of a really strong sort of voice of comedy and personality behind the creation of that video. That's what they were kind of hungry for. And so we noodled around with them on this idea of like, well, why don't we build out a different character that is, can be a sort of a podcasting host. And at the time it was like the early days of Gary Vee and Joe Rogan and all these kind of guys coming up who were like doing these very, you know, alpha podcasts about, you know, get a Lamborghini kind of thing. And that's sort of what we were riffing off. And so we created a character named Dexter Guff. And yeah, that was our first foray of really going into that sort of big podcast scene in America, because we launched the show at Upfronts. Like in America, there was a podcast Upfronts.
The first ever podcast.
Yeah, Upfronts. It was the first ever podcast Upfronts. And so it was a really like, really exciting to be able to like go and see that there was this like larger business at play here, that it was like a real thing, you know, because we had kind of like been slightly protected in our CBC bubble of like, yeah, well, of course you put it out and there's going to be an audience, but really sort of seeing a larger economics behind it was inspiring and kicked us into gear early on with the company.
Ira Glass was there, famous. And
Godfather.
The godfather of podcasting. And he did this really interesting kind of bit or talk where he was like talking about how he wanted bigger advertisers. He was like Don Draper. He was like, I want Coca-Cola. I want American Airlines. He's like, I have so many listeners on my show. Like, why don't I have bigger advertisers? And just talking about how much advertisement money was coming into this field and how people should be getting it. It was really, it was inspiring to be like, yeah, this is a real thing. And it was getting treated like that. And so it was really incredible to be there with a really buzzy New York company, getting featured on stage with our new show. From a Vancouver production standpoint, in production companies that kind of have to navigate that whole like tax credit world, America, financing. It's like, it was very simple. We got engaged by an American company to make a show and we got paid a couple drawdowns. There's no real like, you know, a certain number of Canadians or a certain this, like there's none of that stuff. It's just like very straightforward. Mm-hmm. We made it and then it came out worldwide. Like it's just very simple. They actually own the IP because they paid for the show, but then when they went under, we bought the IP back from them, and now we own the IP.
We have developed that character beyond what any sort of like initial writer's room could do in a television setting, because we had three seasons of really just trying it out and doing everything we possibly could with this character and fully forming it and getting his backstory sorted and putting in all these like nuances around this character. And now when you're approaching a sort of imagining it as a potential television thing, we've done so much of the work to this guy. And, you know, Peter Oldring, who is a longtime kind of Kelly and Kelly collaborator too, he, you know, just has done a masterful job of using podcasting as the sandbox to develop this character. Now it's a highly pitchable thing.
And on top of that, it's like the character is so deeply well known on the creative side. And we also have actual audience feedback. So it's been written up in The Guardian and Slate, and people love the character. Some people don't understand that the character's not real. But those who understand it are obsessed with him. Like we get messages all the time, like, where is Dexter? I need more Dexter in my life. And like Jesse Eisenberg heard it and is like this massive fan of Dexter Guff. He's in season two. Like it's incredible to get that kind of response and then be able to go and pitch it and go like, look how people are connecting with this.
The other thing I'd say about that show, Eric, and that first one with Dexter Guff and Panoply, it's sort of like the story of Kelly and Kelly is also that one show gets another one and gets another one. So then the next big thing we did, somebody, you know, was a fan of Dexter Guff, really connected to the comedy in that show again, didn't necessarily want the same thing, but came to us because they could really see the personality and the comedy chops and the satirical voice coming through and really, you know, identified with that and said, okay, now I want mine. What can you do for me? And so that was the next show that we did with a different network. And that became This Sounds Serious, which is our true crime podcast that has three seasons under its belt. But it really is kind of an interesting thing that the personality of our work kind of transfers through all of these audio projects. And it just one gets another and then builds on another. And then, you know, we're slowly building up this really kind of interesting body of work.
I don't want to jump too far ahead because that is our next topic about, you know, how are these podcasting ambitions going elsewhere? Mm-hmm. However, I do want to say that I've noticed that Dexter Guff has had his own video clips that you've posted online. I believe he was in your Human People demo that you did with TELUS.
Similar character, different, slightly different. Yeah, but.
And right before the pandemic hit, I believe you guys were doing a show at JFL Northwest. With that character, March of 2020.
He did a live show. Yeah, that's right. At JFL Northwest here in Vancouver, he did a.
And how did that go? And was that something I'm like, well, that's another way to develop a character.
Yes.
Podcasting, but also all of a sudden a live show, which makes you guys completely unique compared to other, you know, typical television production companies.
Well, that's exactly it. I mean, and then we did that with This Is That as well. Like, you know, it really easily transferred to a live show because you have such a loyal listening audience, you have the ability to say to them, you know, we're going to be doing a live thing, come and see it. And it becomes a much easier lift to sell tickets. I mean, I guess this is what musicians experience all the time. If they've got successful music, that people will come see them live. But it really was like, it was a really sort of pointed thing for us strategically with Dexter Guff to kind of, let's build out this world. It makes absolute sense that this character would be holding live events. So why don't we try to see what that would be like for him to put on a live event and see if people will come and experience it. And there wasn't a single person in that room who was not totally in love with and familiar with the podcast.
Well, given your background with the Second City, it seems like a perfect fit for your entire company.
It's not an uncommon thing either in podcasting. It's a very, you know, pandemic has sort of ruined that for, I think, everybody touring live stuff. But there was a really massive upward trend right before the pandemic of these podcasts that, you know, have been around for a while and have really built up a loyal niche audience, that it was not impossible at all for them to go on a fairly substantial tour and fill out theaters. Like I've gone to live podcast shows and it's like, you know, it's a 2,500 seat theater of people who are just like rabid fans.
Radio Lab, Two Dope Queens. I mean, different formats.
Goes on and on. So Eric, what I'm saying is shoot for the sky.
Well, when the pandemic's over, I plan on doing a show in front of like maybe
Rogers
five
Arena.
People.
Yeah,
it'll be
no,
great.
No, we're aiming bigger. We're going to go to the Rogers Arena, downtown Vancouver. 30,000 people are going to be watching the three of us talk about podcasting.
Let's make that happen. So let's talk about your other show, which you just mentioned.
This Sounds Serious.
Is this your personal IP? Is this an example of something you guys created in-house and took it to pitch? And who did you pitch it to?
Sure. Yeah. This is original IP. And we pitched it to a network called Castbox through this person who was a big fan of Dexter Guff and said, what do you got? They loved the idea, satirical true crime. It's not real true crime, especially as like such a great parody because people know all the tropes of true crime so well. It's had three seasons. It's a bona fide big hit. It's had over 1 million listens on each season. It was on the New Yorker's top 10 podcasts of 2020 list and was the only scripted fiction of that list. Yeah, now we have all of the rights for a television adaptation and it is currently in development. We can't say with what network yet officially, but we're hoping to hear about whether or not it's going to get the green light into production for 2022. It's a very exciting project.
That's great. And this so perfect transition to our last topic, which is the ambitions for your production company beyond podcasting. And ultimately, what I'm hearing is that you guys are creating these ideas however you can, obviously through podcasting, first and foremost. And that's allowing you to develop ideas, develop stories, and then take them out. So you can't say anything just yet. And hopefully, maybe we'll be able to give our audience an update in a few months and let them know what has transpired. But this is part of the goal right now, is to take these early ideas and bring them to television. And by the way, you've done a TV show this year, which was not born out of podcasting, because I can't imagine that being born out of podcasting, but you did the slowest TV show. Mm-hmm. Let's talk first about the development side of things and taking those early podcasting ideas and taking them to traditional broadcasters and new platforms.
It's really becoming quite revealing to us that, you know, audio is definitely can be viewed as it's a real like incubator kind of space for not only ideas, but for talent too. And there's less risk involved because the budgets are not so high. So we're constantly trying to go out there and pitch to people to say like, hey, unique about this writer or this concept and this team of people behind this show. This is the first stop. Like we're kind of like picking things and looking things and choosing to develop things that we definitely see as audio can be the first stop for them. And let's make it something that is true to the form. So let's make a really, really great audio offering that can A, grab the attention of an audience. Doesn't have to be like 10 gajillion people, but really in a meaningful way, grab the attention of an audience that, you know, really responds to, again, the, you know, the sentiment of the show or the creative team behind the show. And then always like sort of have eyes on, while we're doing that, how can this scale up into a television show or into a larger script for a film or a live kind of touring thing? Or you don't really know, but the idea is it's a sandbox that is, there's very little risk to play in the sandbox as far as from an economic standpoint. So you might as well, and you might as well do it with somebody that you can trust will pull off the production and make it something that's actually quality, because, you know, that's going to speak volumes for when you want to have the discussion about what the next tier of IP development would be. And we've stumbled here and there. We've maybe misstepped a couple of times along the way, but we're starting to get a little bit more like pointed on what that means. And so when we're really thinking about new show ideas, that's kind of our first thought. Does it have the ability to scale up into something bigger? And if it does, right, then it's like worth kind of going out there and pitching it and trying to find somebody to fund it or to partner with it.
Yeah. And I think we just like dream so big with podcasting in the most exciting way. Like when Pat's talking about long tail IP, it's like, yes, television development, because traditional television development is slow, expensive, people are risk averse. So like, yes, we are fully in on television development with podcasts, but also like feature films, live shows, books, video games, NFTs, whatever. Like we can dream so big of what these things could be. Like we don't even know what some of these things could develop into, because it's really endless. Like we're not medium specific with it.
That's right.
It could be so many things. And that's incredible, because when you have a great idea, when you have a great character, when you have great talent, it can develop into a bunch of different things. And really the cleverness, like Pat's saying, of formats. Like there's so much potential in podcasting that hasn't been done. There's so many things from television we haven't seen in podcasting. Like I know I was kind of saying like, oh yeah, there's, it's hard to stand out, you know, like if you weren't an early adopter, but like that's really like we're talking about chat shows or true crime. Like there's a couple of formats that have been done a lot, but there's still a ton of potential in things that haven't been done. And that's where we see a really exciting opportunity of like, make shows that you've seen blow up in television that have not blown up in audio yet. This is like a serious, serious creative sector that needs to like be really taken seriously. And we are seeing that right now. We're seeing every production company wake up to it. It's like the second Smartlist got sold for 80 million. I can't tell you how many emails I got of like, tell us about podcasting again. Like people are starting to be like, huh. And Pat's, we've been preaching this at the Banff Media Festival for the last 5 years, like use podcasting for development. And now you see like Disney Studios, Apple, just hiring podcasters, like Netflix hiring, you know, like you see all of the major networks being like, we're getting into podcasting in these kind of small ways, whether it's with companion podcasts, but you're like, they are using it now for development. They are making original podcasts. They are buying up every independent podcast studio available, whether that be Gimlet or Wondery or Pineapple Street or How Stuff Works. Like there's huge things percolating in the podcasting business that I encourage everyone to kind of take a look at, because there's a lot going on that side. And what we've kind of seen is like podcasting in ad sales is like 1 billion and terrestrial radio is 10 billion, but like these things are just going to get closer together. Like podcasting is going up, right? Like they're going to just become one and the same.
What's exciting to me is that podcasting for you guys is not an afterthought, because
yeah.
And clearly that's what you're saying, is that it's going in a direction where podcasts will continue to grow and the major entertainment players that be are going to start focusing on the potential business of podcasting itself, as opposed to this second screen content that shows up online. Now, very quickly, please talk to me about your newest production, The Slowest TV Show on the CBC, CBC Gem.
You can probably find some sort of like continuity to all the other work that we do too, which is this idea of being a bit clever and like trying to find a new way of doing something. It basically was our stab at doing slow TV, which is, you know, a big kind of trend around the world, which is often
like watching the fireplace.
Yeah, watching the fireplace or beautiful landscapes or natures or waterfalls or whatever it may be. We kind of had this idea, you know, what if you did that, but infused it with comedy and very subtle comedy, sort of like people watching, kind of like a Where's Waldo kind of like screenscape. So we made 6 episodes of this where it's a locked off shot on something that is, you know, interesting in and of itself to look at. For example, like a wave pool come and go during the day. But the more you kind of key into it and you start sort of people watching, you start to sort of pick up on the little subtle storylines that are happening, whether it's like a piece of conflict between two characters or a bit of physical comedy off in the top screen. So they're about 20 minutes long each episode. And the idea is that you can just put it on and it seemingly looks like something nice that you could just put on the screen in your living room and, you know, it fills the space. But the more you kind of pay attention, you might start catching things and you can put it on over and over again and still not find everything.
How did you pitch that?
Pretty much like that.
And during the pandemic, I think. So you, I'm assuming you got on a Zoom call and you pitched this idea about that. That's like more nothing than Seinfeld itself.
Yeah, it was really, you know, it was the idea that I think we just sort of pitched it really just kind of by explaining the fact that slow TV, you know, has such a presence in the content ecosystem, but there's not a single version of it that's funny. I think that instantly made people kind of like perk up to the idea. You know, when we started to kind of like describe the sort of Where's Waldo sort of nature of it and the fact that we all have these jumbo screens in our living room and sometimes you want to put it on but you don't want to put anything on, you want to just have it on while you're folding laundry or whatever. So we really dove into kind of like how people would use it and why it makes sense to have this sort of offering, because we do all use the fireplace channel, so why don't we use something like this? And so definitely an experiment on their part to kind of green light it, but they were on board. And that, you know, another piece of it too was, again, sort of speaking to sort of the ethos of our company and a lot of the work that we do, it's like we saw it as a real opportunity to bring in new talent as well. You know, the risk for bringing in new directors who may not have directed a whole bunch of stuff.
Right.
You know, this is not a huge challenge for them to direct something like this. It can, the camera's locked off, but really they're like, what they're directing is the comedic performances and all that kind of stuff. So we really used it as a bit of an incubator to like bring in and give opportunity to some new writers and directors and comedians.
So if you are in Canada and you're listening to this, you can check that out on CBC Gem and another great Vancouver company on the rise. So I wish you guys much success in the next little while. And thanks again for spending your time with me.
Thank you, Eric.
Thanks, it's a pleasure. Eric.
Yeah.
All right. Take care. Bye.
And that concludes today's episode of Global Vid. Thanks to my guests, Pat Kelly and Lauren Berkovich of Kelly and Kelly, our editor, Nicole Almeida, and our theme song composers, Amber Goodwin and Aaron Ross. See you next time.